Hello, hello, Mordimers here, and welcome to one more very nice miniature, maybe not so spectacular like yesterday, because yesterday we had all combo. We have a queen sacrifice, we have a checkmate in 11 moves, we had the opera mate and ready mate all in one, so very spectacular game, but this game gonna be much more educational, so maybe from educational point of view more important. And it was played in Sankt Petersburg in 1914 after the tournament, which was won by Aron Nimzowitsch and Alexander Aliehin together. And it was played as an offhand game. Of course, everybody wanted to play with the winners if have that chance. So Aron Nimzowitsch as white, and he was already at that time number 5 in the world, with the ranking estimated by Chessmetrics as 2737, and he was 27 years old at that time. And Aron Nimzowitsch is known as the author of the most influential book in chess history, My System. And this game I'm gonna show you today is part of this book. Is one example to the chapter of developing the pieces, and you will understand why it's so important to develop the pieces after you see this game. And his opponent is Semyon Alapin, one of the strongest Russian players of 19th century. However, in 1914 he was already 57 years old, but as you see, he still enjoyed chess, and his estimated ranking was 2568. So without further ado, let's jump into the game. Nimzowitsch open with e4. We have e6, d4, d5, French defense, knight on c6, knight f6, and here the most popular, of course, is e5 or bishop on g5. However, Nimzowitsch went for the exchange variation, the late exchange variation, and he played e takes on d5. And here, knight on d5. Normally, e takes on d5 is the most solid, the most popular, and Nimzowitsch in the book wrote that, okay, black already give up the center because they don't have this pawn which controls e4, which is quite important. So it's against the principles written in his book. And of course, Alapin couldn't read this book because it was written 10 years later. We have knight on f3, we have c5 challenging the pawn in the center, and now knight on d5, queen on d5, and bishop on e3. And this is another principle from the book, overprotecting. So now d4 pawn is protected 1, 2, 3 times. So that's the idea. And also now this pawn can actually attack c5, and bishop will not come with tempo. Okay, it will come with tempo, but it's gonna be exchanged, so the tempo is gonna, you know, just vanish. We have c takes on d4 by Alapin, and now knight d4. Knight d4 with some crazy ideas, you know. Now this knight can be very, very naughty, you know, fork everything wherever it goes. So Alapin just play a6, okay? And now bishop e2. Bishop e2 developing move, preparing the castle, but also asking black queen, what you gonna do? You gonna stay in the center? It's like quite nice position, but what if you can take the pawn? So taking the pawn in the opening where you lack the development like this is never a good idea, especially if it's not central pawn, and g2 is definitely not the central pawn. But Alapin took it, and this is why we have this beautiful miniature. Of course, in this position e5 was okay, bishop e7 was okay, but queen g2 was played. And okay, we have bishop on f3 attacking the queen, but also defending the rook. And now, according to the Stockfish, everything is okay with black position, and the line to save the game would be queen on h3, okay? And after rook on g1, making some difficulties with developing the pieces. E5 kicking the knight, very important, the knight have to move. So knight b3, knight c6. Now of course this knight didn't control c6, so c6 can be played. And now queen e2, g6, just, you know, let black develop the bishop, and after castle, bishop e7, the position is considered as, you know, equal. Okay, black has even extra pawn, but white slightly better development, so it's considered to be equal. However, Alapin didn't have, you know, access to Stockfish, so he played queen on g6. We have queen on d2, also very important move. It prepares the castle for white and also controls b4. Okay, it's also quite important because this bishop now can't go to b4, and if white would like to play something like c3, it would be very uncomfortable to castle and have this queen on this diagonal without the pawn on c2. So queen on d2, definitely good move. And look at the position. Black still didn't develop any pieces, and white already, you know, developed almost everything. They are ready to castle, and then this rook gonna play, this rook on gonna play. Beautiful position for white. And what black is doing? Try to develop. Knight on c6 is impossible because this knight actually controls c6. It's not the best way to develop in this moment. So e5 was played by Alapin. And believe me or not, but Nimzowitsch in this position play the same move which was played yesterday, if you remember the game. Castle, just castle on the queen side. So rook is coming to the game, so he sacrificed the knight, and look at this king is still in the center and don't really have time to hide. We have e takes on d4. If bishop on e7, it could be slightly better, maybe even much better, because after rook h on g1, putting the pressure on g7, black actually can't really stay here around, because there is another threat, queen on c3, and attacking this bishop, and also this bishop slicing diagonal and watching in b7. Very complicated position. So black would have to find the move like queen on d6, giving the opportunity actually to block the queen if the queen comes here, so that would be pretty useful. But after a knight on f5 attacking the queen, exchanging the queens, let's say, and g6, knight g7, it looks pretty good, especially with the rook on the open d-file. So a king f8, and now bishop h6, king g8, and now knight e8, and white actually can play whatever, knight c7, even bishop on g7, and winning the exchange is possible, but rook is already not playing, so maybe not the best idea. Rook on e1, you know, developing the rooks, attacking the center, definitely white have very nice, very comfortable position. So bishop on e7 was the last chance of black, but still not enough, of course, to, you know, to hold that game. But in the game, Alapin thought, okay, so I take the knight and let's see what you have. We have bishop on d4. And as you see, white already start to threatening the checkmate. So bishop on g7 and queen d8, that would be a checkmate. So Alapin tried to do something about that, and finally he developed his knight. Knight c6, defending d8, but it's too late. Nimzowitsch played the best move in the position. Bishop on f6, threatening beautiful opera mate, so sacrificing the queen, and then rook would follow, and that would be beautiful opera mate. Alapin, of course, didn't want to be checkmated this way, so queen on f6, taking the bishop and also defending this d8 square, but it's already too late. So feel free to pause the video and find the checkmate in 3 moves while I enjoy my cup of tea. Okay, ready? I know not very difficult today. Bishop on c6, just winning the game. And now whatever black play, b takes on c6, rook h on e1, bishop e7, queen d8, that's a checkmate because bishop is of course pinned by the rook. And if queen on c6, this losing even faster because queen on d8. And finally, king e7 also doesn't work, rook h on e1, and now bishop on e6, queen Qd7, that is a checkmate. So congratulations to everybody. I know it was not very difficult, and Nimzowitsch didn't play that move. He played slightly slower, but still winning move, rook h on e1 with check. We have bishop on e7, and now bishop c6. He played king on f8, and now queen on d8, and after taking the queen, rook on e8. And that's the final position of the game. So very beautiful, very educational. So you see how important is developing the pieces. And in this position, if actually black tries something like b takes on c6, it doesn't work for the same reason. Queen d8 is a checkmate. And if try something like bishop on d7, that would be the best answer, but it's still not enough, because queen on d7, king f8, queen d8, rook on d8, rook on d8, bishop d8, and rook finally on e8. It would be even more beautiful, because only two pieces, you know, left, and checkmate black king. However, in the game we had the exactly the same position, but with three extra pieces on the board. So yeah, that's all for today. If you like my content, please consider to subscribe, and thanks for watching, and see you in the next one.